Hi, you're listening to On the Health Record. I'm your host, Oleg Kujikov, and today I sit down with Eugene Borukhovich, who's currently the chairman and COO of YourCoach Health, a practice management solution for health coaches. Eugene's been an influential figure in the healthcare space for a long time, and he met the DrChrono founders, Michael and Daniel, at a Health 2.0 event in San Francisco, which showcases the latest healthcare technology and products. Health 2.0 has evolved over the years, and to learn more, you can check out our episode with Matthew Holt from 2018. Eugene had a really interesting perspective on the world of big pharma, where he worked for many years, and his pivot to the health coaching industry after being part of his wife's cancer treatment journey was a fascinating conversation. We also talk about the health coaching industry and its growing demand and legitimacy over the years, as well as some personal projects such as his own podcast, YouTube channel, and book about navigating the corporate world of pharmaceuticals. With his experience working for pharmaceutical industry titans, in addition to early stage startups, Eugene is able to bring important insights to so many healthcare industry topics. I hope you enjoy this interview as much as I did. I certainly learned a lot. And with all that being said, let's roll the tape. All right, Eugene Borukhovich. He's deeply associated with the digital health and health tech space, has been for many years. You know, Eugene's been employed in the space, you've advised in the space, you've organized events in the space. Currently, though, he's the COO of YourCoach Health. He's a blogger, book writer, and thought leader. Eugene, thanks for taking the time to sit down with me today.
No, it's absolutely a pleasure, especially for my friends at DrChrono, who, you know, speaking of events, I think I met the founding team, Michael and Daniel, at Health 2.0 events in New York City. So happy to do this.
Happy to have you. I wasn't going to go there quite yet, but since you mentioned Health 2.0 and DrChrono, tell us a little bit about the history there, because I've had a guest on the show, Matthew Holt, before, who's helped organize the event. So yeah, let's start there. What's that all about and what's your story there?
Yeah. So I'm going to rewind back probably to, like, holy crap, 2007-ish, I want to say. So I started this New York healthcare technology meetup. And, you know, after a few meetups, I had this gentleman, Dan Kogan, do a pitch of a company called Health World Web. And that's actually the first startup that I joined, as I like to describe, the one-man garage show, Dan. So he's awesome. And he actually introduced me to, I think, Matthew and Esther Dyson and many others in that community very early on. Mm-hmm. And so I remember approaching Matthew and I said, hey, you know, I have this New York healthcare technology meetup thing going on here. Why don't we just do this as a Health 2.0 chapter? And I think this was, I'll say, the first chapter outside of the San Francisco Health 2.0. And I don't remember which meeting that was at. You know, I'm sure that, you know, internet won't lie, so you can search for it. But I think Daniel and Michael pitched DrChrono. And then next thing I know, they were at the San Francisco Health 2.0 big event. So that's how far it goes.
Yeah, so right there at the inception, I think 2007, DrChrono was like just an idea and probably incorporated like 2008, 2009. So
that makes sense, because I think 2008 was officially the first meetup sometime in 2008 or 7. Mm-hmm. So anyway, cool. Yeah.
Yeah. How has that whole event grown over the years? You know, that was almost 12, 13, 14 years ago. And you've been kind of involved for a long time. Yeah, just big picture, how has that event grown? How has the industry grown since DrChrono was a seed?
Yeah, so, you know, I think it's interesting, right? Because it sort of evolved. And since you had Matthew on, you know, Health 2.0 to digital health to now he's calling it Smack Health or whatever the derivatives are. So I'm not the one to talk about Health 2.0. I think you should probably ask Matthew back. I don't know when was the last time you had him on this podcast. Obviously, the company sold to him. And so, you know, good, bad, or indifferent. I think the name, even the... I think even the Twitter handle has already disappeared. Having said all that, you know, I think there's a combination of a consumer-driven health that was sort of the foundations of that back in the day. And I think as some of the young entrepreneurs and startups were trying to discover what is that business model, and it's been taken, you know, full circles, but I'm sure, you know, if we want to, we can dive into it. So I think the you know, depending on which country you're looking at, but in US, I think there is the consumerism of health has revived, especially as we've hit the pandemic. I think there's much more visibility into our own health, or at least acknowledgement that we need to do a lot more self-care just because the system under stress. But I think, you know, some of the companies that have been around, you know, some like DrChrono are still alive and well and kicking, and many are somewhere in the graveyard, right?
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about yourself and kind of how we got here today, where you're the chief operating officer of YourCoach Health, as well as advising like digital health companies.
Yeah. So I honestly, I mean, my sort of, I'll say the combination of entrepreneurial bug and the digital health bug, I owe it to Dan, who I joined on that journey. I just joined somewhere around that same time-ish. I was working at a company called Medco Health at the time. It's a pharmacy benefit management company. And so I've been already in healthcare world. And then I got to see this entrepreneurial side a bit, right? As I joined Dan on that journey. You know, I think part of that, and I never looked back, meaning prior to the healthcare industry, I've spent some time in, you know, entertainment and financial industry. And to me, the healthcare industry is probably the most rewarding because you're helping individuals, you know, to better their health, right? At the end of the day. Mm-hmm. So, you know, probably about 10 years I spent at a pharmacy benefit manager altogether while having that startup. Luckily, you know, with some hard work and also luck, we sold the company. At the time, I actually took a role in the same company, Medco, but abroad, so headquartered in Amsterdam, to drive their international expansion from an information technology perspective. So as a CIO for their international consulting, same thing in digital health and health care, and then ended up at a big pharma for a couple of years, and now back into the startup world, which is I probably enjoy the most at YourCoach Health. I joined my wife about a year ago on that journey. So that's, I don't know, 67 seconds or so.
Yeah, about 15 years in a minute. Tell us about YourCoach Health. That's your latest venture. What's it all about?
Yeah, so we're you know, a very early stage company. You know, the premise, and I guess a little bit of the background. My wife, while we're living in Amsterdam, went through breast cancer. Luckily, you know, all is well. But one of the things she realized is that while the healthcare system helped tremendously, I mean, you know, she went through everything, including, you know, chemo, mastectomy, radiotherapy. She realized that they forgot about part, you know, her mind, parts of her body, and her soul. And so she became a health coach herself, started practicing. And then, you know, we sort of assembled the gang together with Dan and say, okay, well, you can't do this on a piece of paper. You need a good practice management solution to manage it. And there were a few out there, but nothing that's modern. And so while we were, I'll say, developing some components of that, you know, throughout, officially we launched as YourCoach Health in January of 2020, which at the core of it is a practice management solution for health and wellness coaches to bring on their clients and to manage their relationships, as well as, you know, create programs and manage everything from task to communication. And then on the front end, we are honestly experimenting with a number of revenue stream and models to see what kind of sticks at these early stages. But we've been able in about a year-ish to gather over 1,000 coaches on the platform and loving every moment.
Can you tell me more about what a health coach is? You know, I kind of did some research before the podcast and I have an idea, but it seems like they don't fit, you know, quite in the provider patient workflow. So where does health coaching fit into healthcare and the whole workflow there?
So, you know, health coaching as a field actually has been around for 20 years or so, right? I would say, you know, and I don't like using the term legitimacy, but that's the reality of it. Some of the legitimacy started coming in when end of 2000 2019, I want to say, when the AMA, the American Medical Association, basically announced, not in their direct words, but it's a non-clinical member of a healthcare team, and actually released some test CPT codes, so reimbursement codes for health coaching. Okay.
That's a big deal.
These are test codes. They're not reimbursable yet, right? So they're out for testing in Veteran Affairs and many other places. But again, I think part of that, it is a science-backed, behavior-driven way to help you as an individual understand and reach your goals. So that's kind of the, you know, a two-sentence summary of health and wellness coaches. Now, you know, the one thing we also say, health coach, so a certified, especially a certified health and wellness coach, and there's a standards body. So National Board of Health and Wellness Coaching is a standards body. They're a nonprofit organization that qualify everything from schools to certifications. And actually you need to go, in order for a health coach to ultimately be reimbursed, they would need to have their national board certification, which is not easy. There's maybe about 4,000 to 5,000 of the coaches with that certification to date. Okay. Lastly, I started saying a health and wellness coach, we like to say it's not necessarily a doctor, but a doctor can go and get their health and wellness coaching degree, right, and the certification. A health and wellness coach is not a dietitian, but a dietitian can get health and wellness coaching certification. And I actually, as a CEO of a company that's all about health coaching, I decided to go through a program which is called Well Coaches. Normally it's 18 weeks. We did it in 9 weeks just because it's, you know, during COVID, we went online. So it was more lessons per week. But my summary is, it's a non-clinical psychotherapist, and it takes very much of a empathy and how you are listening. So mostly listening to people, and again, understanding and diving with lots of questions, because the reality is the answers are all in you, right? As an individual, always.
And would you say the healthcare system has been missing that kind of empathy or listening piece for, you know, any point in time?
I mean, look, there's, you know, we can talk about bedside manner, right, of different docs, and everybody has their own. I mean, we're all at the end of the day individuals. I think part of the challenges as we've been digitizing the healthcare experience for good, bad, or indifferent, right? And I actually think for good. I think that patient-doctor relationship has disappeared, because when a doc is seeing 40, 50, 60 patients, I don't even know how many, right? It just disappears. Nurses are there, right, in the hospital setting, of course, to help, but the same thing. I mean, they're doing a lot of administrative work, EMR, EHR work, right? Entering a lot of the stuff in. And so we do believe that the healthcare system has been missing it. And only now, I think we're starting to see the whole, I'll say, the health and wellness market and the healthcare market are coming together much closer. And so we are seeing this, you know, let's take any digital therapeutic company or disease management, I call it 2.0. So a company like a Livongo employs health coaches, right, surrounding it, or Vita Health or Verda. So there are health coaches that are now helping patients to understand and reach their goals. And so the markets, the two worlds are coming together much closer, and I would say in the last 2 to 3 years.
So coaching, I think, is, you know, it's an understatement to say coaching is so important. I think good coaching is extremely valuable. Coaching is something near and dear to my heart. You know, I'm formerly an athlete. I actually coached some swimming and water polo myself. Today I work in a technical role as a, you know, scrum master. And that involves working with teams to figure out how to improve their process and performance, which is just another fancy way of saying coaching. In your own words, just in general, what's the core value of having experienced coaches or just coaches in general?
Yeah, so I mean, I want to separate out, because a coach could be a football coach, right? You know, a fitness coach. I want to separate out a life coach, by the way, also, right? And all of them have their place. I do want to separate out, again, a national board certified health and wellness coach, And if you go through one of those sessions or you know how to lead a session, you'll clearly understand. By the way, a lot of the health and wellness coaches also do work with leaders in companies, right? Because I think at the core of it, it's, once again, I'll just summarize it. It's really being able to ask the right questions at the right time. It's being able to listen pretty intensively, actually. And there are methodologies like motivational interviewing, reflections, you know, things like that, that you can lead and guide your client. Notice I don't say patient, by the way. So we've actually been adamant as Your Coach Health not calling individuals patients. Because a coach may have, a diabetes patient as their client, but the diabetes does not define that person, right? And so there are other aspects holistically that that person wants to be, I'll say, helped as a general.
Right. And that seems like such an important distinction. You know, you step into the doctor's office, you're there for a reason, right? There's an appointment, there's a reason for a visit. It is diabetes, but when you are kind of being coached, it's so important to look at the whole picture, not just like, okay, we're here for this. It's like, we got to look at all these things that add up to your life.
Absolutely.
I see the distinction. I see it being, I see the value, and we've kind of talked about why it's really important to have these coaches. Why now? Why is the timing now?
Yeah. I mean, so a couple of tailwinds, right? When we officially incorporated in January of 2020, and then, you know, this, I want to say November, December of 2019, we got this huge tailwind of the AMA, right? Sort of, again, I'll use the word legitimizing the profession, the test CPT codes. And then as soon as COVID hit, you know, if you think about it, all of the comorbidities and all of the inefficiencies of the healthcare system just kind of floated right up to the top, right? And I think ultimately, again, if I go back to at least my quick, funny definition of a non-clinical psychotherapist, boy, everybody can use one now, right? Because access to, and again, I want to make sure that the listeners understand, a health coach is not a psychotherapist. It's not a psychiatrist. It is a non-clinical. And so, this is the time where all of these things that sort of legitimizing the industry, reimbursement codes, the National Board of the Health and Wellness Coaching, you know, really got moving and going, and the dire need of individuals to be able to talk through their health goals and how do I reach them in these, you know, crazy times. So those are probably some of the key why now points.
Yeah. So, you know, you're the COO of this company. It's a digital health company. You sort of explained to me the need. It sounds like, you know, a good idea. Sounds like a reasonable solution. You know, you advise other digital health companies. So you're clearly in sync with like the space. It's where you live. So in terms of digital health, give me like a temperature check. Where are we at in 2021 with digital health and technology? Tell me about the technology being used in the industry.
So I'll, in order for it to give you my thoughts now, I'll rewind back just a few years, maybe 3 to 5 in total. So first of all, every industry needs a buzzword, and digital health was it. I think everybody packed so much stuff into it. I do think even DrChrono was part of this digital health, rankings, numbers, and all of that good stuff that, you know, as the fundraisers, for example. I think what happened over the last, let's call it 5 years for the sake of our listeners, the industry matured, the models have been kind of figured out, but some of these companies started falling into their own places, right? And to me, it's very much in how do you either digitize and optimize existing processes? How do you enable better, quicker communication on the other side? You know, if I look into pharma, you know, some of the even AI tools and drug discovery were bundled into digital health. I would argue it's not; it's R&D. But again, you know, this influx of startups and companies that pitched ideas across the board, across the value chain, started falling into place. And so, in summary, where I see this now is, as we joked around in another podcast, that the suits are here because this is real business. It fell into places, and And I think digital health as a term is actually, in my opinion, starting to disappear. And there may be even subsegments that are starting to appear. So for example, you know, I'm doing actually a whole podcast on digital therapeutics. You know, that's a very clear definition and a subset of the overall and overarching digital health. You know, to me, I'll say the AI chatbots that are servicing primary care markets, right, are not necessarily AI chatbots. To me, they're tools to communicate and communication tool that fell into place for patients to get, you know, at least quick, I wouldn't call diagnosis, but routing to the right set of specialists on the other side of it. So succinctly, digital health has evolved. It's no longer enough to have just an idea and one person in a garage working on a tech solution. You need to be a very cohesive team with different credibilities and backgrounds. And there's not just investment. I mean, we've seen IPOs now, right, in the space.
So healthcare is huge. You know, it takes up $3 to $4 trillion of the national GDP and growing. That's a number that's so big, I don't even really know what it means. Does digital health fit into that slice of pie, or is it its own thing?
So I think I've been describing this for years now. You know, if we do look at it as a slice of a pie or a pizza pie, while it is growing, everybody is trying to prevent it from growing just because governments and payers just cannot afford it anymore and more comes out of the pocket. And so I do think it's an imperative piece of it. And again, I look at it with two lenses. On one side, it's something that will bring efficiency and transparency into the marketplace. So I'll take like a GoodRx, you know, for drug price transparency that, you know, IPO'd. Is an example. But on the other side, it's novel techniques of even treatments, right? So again, I'll use an example of digital therapeutics. So something like paratherapeutics Somrest for insomnia, which is a digital tool to treat insomnia, literally treat insomnia. So I think it's in that pie. In some cases, my opinion, the pie is not going to be growing much more. It needs to shrink, right? And so it'll hit some of the efficiencies, but then it also help develop some new modalities of things that we could not even foresee. I mean, think about it. I'll give one other example of like Achille Interactive. It's a game. Literally, you play a game to treat ADHD. Right? Who would have thought that even 5 years ago? Well, the Achille founders did, but probably the masses would never think that.
Eugene, so you mentioned you have a creative side too. You love podcasts. You might even be doing some podcasts, and you're writing a book, Hard Pill to Swallow. Let's start with those two things. So podcasts and the book. Tell me a little bit about each one.
So I'll give you a little bit about the book first, and won't dive too much into it. It was, you know, as I spent time in big corporates, I think part of that is, and specifically in healthcare industry and pharma, realization as the industries grow, they are successful. You know, there are good margin in that business, and what's preventing them from even being more successful, right? And having even better outcomes. And the first thing I'll say about the pharma industry is it's been saving lives. It's been extending people's lives for dozens and dozens of years, right? And so I look at it very much from a, you know, corporate structure decision making. And because I've never written a book before, I decided to sort of make myself, I guess, very transparent in my process. So my goal is to write a teaser every Friday. And so on one side, engage my potential readers on that journey. So, you know, every week I've skipped here and there, but very much every week I do try to write a little bit. And also, like I said earlier, engage my ultimate readers into that process. So you can even ask some questions on, if you were me, would you do X, Y, or Z, right? As to continuation. So the point of the book is honestly experiences in the industry, lessons learned, and some anecdotes for other intrapreneurs that are trying to navigate something new, novel, and something that a core business, no matter what industry it is, it's a cash cow. And how do you actually step out of it? It's a little bit of a dilemma for intrapreneurs. So that's the book. That's kind of my journey so far. I think I've had maybe 20 to 21 posts, aka chapter previews. And now I'm diving deeper.
Yeah, that's so interesting. Can you talk about what that's like? I imagine that, you know, I'm interested. Anyone listening, probably interested. And I imagine there's not a lot of people with experience interactively writing a book. So what's it like kind of putting chapters out there, getting feedback and the experience? Yeah, would you recommend it, I guess?
Yeah, so honestly, let me be frank again. I've never written a book. The quote unquote, I go away, I write a book, and you know, I go through the whole publishing process, and here it is, and voila, and I hear feedback. So for me, the only way to do it is actually this way, and I'm absolutely fascinated. You know, when I press that send button and it goes out to these hundreds and hundreds of subscribers, I'm like anxiously waiting by the mailbox, right, for feedback and thoughts and anecdotes. And actually, another gentleman, Paul Sims, who is another pharma provocateur, he was writing to me back every week. And so I actually asked him to join me in sporadic Fridays to, I'll use some of his output or input as an output to my previous post, right? Mm-hmm. So it is absolutely fascinating. I don't know how people can write in their own box. And just now, having said that, there's a lot of research, so that happens. I guess it depends on what kind of book you're writing, and which is now missing, right? Because if I want to dive deeper, I would love to actually interview additional people. And by the way, there's volunteers that come in my way too. Hey, I may have some anecdotes for you, right? Mm-hmm. So it's fascinating. I highly recommend it, doing it this way.
Yeah. And I mean, I hear like almost rhymes when you talk about that, because it sounds like podcasts, right? It's like you put this thing out, you wait for people to get back to you, and you're actually kind of harnessing feedback in a very like live kind of way. Just tell me more about what you do, how you engage with content online. Is it mostly podcasts and books, or are you doing anything else that's interesting?
Yeah, so I'm also doing two. Well, I guess one, we really call it a YouTube show, and that started when the pandemic hit last March. A friend of mine, Jim Joyce, he's another entrepreneur based in Dublin. I was in, you know, in my mother-in-law's garage. we left Berlin very quickly before we got here to Barcelona, and so we spent 9 months, eight and a half months, but who's counting, in New Jersey garage of my mother-in-law's. Jim reached out to me. We always talked about, hey, you know, every time we actually meet at a bar after a digital health event, we talk real talk with a bunch of other people. Let's emulate that. And as the pandemic hit, and you know, Jim reached out saying, let's do this. It's been a highlight now for us since last March, right? So we're, you know, over almost, I think almost at 50 episodes. We've been doing this every single Wednesday, have not missed one. And it's called The Shot of Digital Health Therapy. So, and it's literally, I'll take a shot once in a while. We have a guest on every week. We have random seasons. Well, not that random anymore. We decided a season is 10 episodes plus one recap. So we're on to season 5 already, which means nothing, because the whole, and it was a COVID-free zone, right? So you're not supposed to say COVID or C-19 or pandemic. This was our gateway. That's what we started this as, a YouTube. So recording on Zoom, putting up on YouTube. And then a good friend, Dan Kendall, who actually runs the Digital Health Today podcast, and now a larger company called Mission Based Media. I think after the first episode, he's like, why don't you make it into a podcast too? And here's how you do it. And so he actually walked me and Jim through it. And it's, so now you can watch it on YouTube. You can listen to the podcast. I find I consume media depends on my mood, right? I'll, you know, sometimes when I'm just kind of sitting or in the break, I do want to see, you know, a YouTube video instead. But then I love the fact, like, I don't know, Joe Rogan, I'll pick an example. You can watch the same episode on YouTube, or you can switch over to a Spotify or whatever your podcast. So that's one. I got the love for podcasting through that and using my other part of the brain. And so I mentioned earlier digital therapeutics. I've been a, an early watcher of the industry. When I still was at a big pharma company, we actually joined the first life sciences company to join a digital therapeutic alliance, which is basically bringing together standards and frameworks for that industry. So I went on, a journey discovering digital therapeutics as a market, but also the trailblazers and entrepreneurs that have been driving this, you know, sub-industry, let's call it, in the healthcare space. And that's been a very different approach and very fascinating, because I need to actually prepare and not just shoot the proverbial sh on a YouTube channel.
Yeah. Wow. Well, you know, you've done so many different things. You have so many approaches for kind of pushing change in this space. Do you have a favorite amongst, you know, organizing big events, having conversations and recording them, writing online, pushing that out and seeing what your engagement is like? Is there like a, is there a best method for getting your message out there and driving change in this industry?
Yeah. So, you know, it's funny, if I had a penny every time I got to ask that question. And my answer is actually, do what feels authentic to you as an individual, really, right? Because the one piece that people can pick up is no authenticity, right? When you're reading something, when you're, you know, when you're kind of told what to say, or you really like super practice it, you know, I engage, my medium today is Twitter. That's where I mostly engage, right? I write when I, you know, I do force myself. So I think consistency is the other piece, you know, and this is why, like, the Friday that I miss my heart pill to swallow update, I kick myself in the ass quite a bit. Again, I don't want to force it. So the creativity, it needs to come out. It needs to be authentic. You know, consistency every Wednesday having the shadow digital health. So I think people, because of this world is just crazy and unpredictable, I think people enjoy consistency and authenticity. And then as long as you have those two, I don't think it matters which channel, because you'll get a tribe following, for lack of a better term, on whatever medium you are.
Awesome. All right. I want to keep talking about the book. I want to keep talking about big pharma. Here's where I stand. Big pharma, I'm young. I'm like 26. I don't really understand what the problem is. I understand that they're kind of, they're big and they have, you know, a lot of sway. And I see what I see in my experience in life is that, you know, opioid crisis is very bad in the United States. It seems like around pharmacies and big pharma, there's shady business dealings, and that seems pretty common. It seems like they have a lot of capital, huge market share with not a lot of incentive to change or innovate or do anything new. I'm not saying they're to blame for the current mental health crisis, but I don't think they're helping. So what exactly is like the fault right now of these pharma companies, and what can we actually hope to fix? What problems are manageable, right?
So let me, to answer that question, I'll actually back up. I started my book, while I can beat the heck out of all the bits and pieces and processes and a lot of the stuff that you said, I actually want to step back and say that our longevity as a society has increased over time, right? And whether we like it or not, whichever side you're on it, actually the molecular and biological knowledge that we as a society have gained is due to some of the investments that pharma made. And they've been extending lives of people. They've been saving lives of people. And absolutely, I think with any technology, right? I mean, if you think about even the good old press, there was evil and there was great stuff done. So I think you will have abusers on both sides of that same technology. And by same technology, I mean, obviously, there's many modalities in the biological processes. I do think, and there's been some surveys, obviously, with the vaccines being out, I think pharma has improved significantly in what people or masses think of a pharmaceutical industry. Mm-hmm. The last piece to this, I think this crisis that the whole society is going through now has also proved that you can bring drugs to market much, much, much quicker. You need to have, you know, the right incentives in place and the right regulatory frameworks, because one of the things that people say always, well, pharma is so focused on a particular asset or particular drug, why aren't they helping holistically to you as an individual, right? Well, in theory, they can't because of some of the regulations, right? You need to get some of these individual drugs out. It's only for a cardiovascular disease or for oncology or whatever. And so I do think it's a combination of regulatory frameworks that look what happened with vaccinations, speeding up the approval, speeding up the trials, and pushing pharma into really the digital age, which some of people like myself have been preaching, you know, well, virtual clinical trials, right? Or digital tools. So it's a long way to answer that. Again, in summary for our listeners, is there's always, you know, a good and the evil on that same side of the coin and same type of technology. And I do believe that it's more good than evil. Okay. Mm-hmm. And there'll be accidents and people even went to jail in this industry, right? For some of this stuff, I won't mention names. Mm-hmm. And then secondly, again, I think the crisis brought, and I think it will reshape the pharmaceutical industry, because the expectations, right, wrong, or indifferent, again, from a pharmaceutical industry is that why can't we get an mRNA equivalent for a particular cancer out in the next 12 months too? Why does it need to take 10 years, right? So we'll see what comes out of it. I think all the focus now is on vaccines. I do think that industry will be reshaped when this crisis is, you know, let's call it, put it in quotes, over. But
yeah, it's probably won't be a clean ending. And I wonder about the pandemic and the crisis and how it's sort of shaped things. I guess my question is, you know, what have you seen from COVID-19 and how the industry's responded? And do you think it's more of an accelerant or a game changer, where it's sort of taken trends and accelerated them? Or do you think it's completely flipped the board and changed the game?
Personally, I think it's been a huge accelerator, and there's been, you know, things like, I think it was Roberto Acione from Healthware said it's like 10 decades in 10 days, right? Or something similar to that. You know, the startup health team also had their, you know, so very much around acceleration. Forcing people to go into the telemedicine mode, right? I mean, you know, I'm not sure what you guys are seeing, Dr. Krona, and adoption of some of the more, you know, technologically advanced tools, you know, remote patient monitoring because you couldn't do it, virtual clinical trials because you couldn't get to it, you know, Salesforce back to pharma, you know, all of a sudden couldn't visit the doctors and nag them, right? So a lot of that accelerated some of the investments that were maybe going to take another 10 years, literally. Now, with any acceleration, in my opinion, comes a huge pivotal point as well, because, you know, everybody leaned into educating themselves on how to do things online, right? Visiting docs via telemedicine platforms, and the list keeps going on. Actually, digital therapeutics, again, you know, got for specialist psycho and mental disease states, right? FDA allowed them to go straight to market during this time. So more real world data is being collected on the positive or negative impacts of it. And guess what? Again, I think it will flip and we'll see new innovations and miniaturizations of what is being done now. But one thing I'm hoping for is that we're actually going to bring the human back to digital health. Yeah. And this is, again, we all need some empathy. We all need some care. We all need somebody to talk to and not necessarily an icon or a chatbot, right?
So, yeah. Yeah, let's not forget the human bit. This whole conversation, I keep thinking about balance, you know, and moderation. Like the tools are great in moderation. The pharma and what medicine does, it's great in moderation. Same with the digital health tools. So you advise digital health companies, and you've mentioned a few emerging technologies, you know, digital therapeutics a few times, and even the chatbots. You know, you have your pulse on the industry, so to speak. What are a few of the most exciting emerging technologies to keep your eye on in 2020 and moving forward in digital health?
Yeah, I'm a huge fan, and even though the product has been around quite a while, but like the CGM, the continuous glucose monitors, I'll extend it out to other FDA approved, maybe even in some cases prescription only, depends on the country, monitors of your biological activities, let's put it that way, that will be now used for more mainstream and performance optimization of individuals, right? So again, I'll call out like Levels Health that uses actually CGM, but more on, you know, how do I understand my metabolic health better as an individual, right? So that's one. And the second part is, I think we will see more of, even though it's around today, but again, more clinical validation around self-help tools. So I'll call out, even to a certain extent, while it might be prescription, it's still self-help in a sense, like back to this Achilles game or paratherapeutic somrist, or a Happify DTX, you know, from a mental health perspective. Because guess what? The healthcare system just can't keep up, right? And so we all gotta help each other. That's two. You know, I think we'll see continuous new modalities, even in the technological perspective. I mean, you know, I do have a chip in my hand. It's pretty dumb. It's basically an RFID chip today, where I can kind of scan it and I'll have my V card and my link to the DNA data. But I think some of those insertables that will actually, again, be monitoring our biological data. And hey, at some point, maybe it'll actually stream into a DrChrono platform, which will make sense out of it all for the individual docs and individuals, right? So just, you know, I think those are three. If you notice, the theme is all around our own human biology, because there's still so much unknown to it. And we've been capturing data inside or outside of our bodies more and more now. And I think this is the real next frontier, because we're finding some business models around it now, right? And I'll use, again, Levels Health as an example.
So we're finding business models that work. When will digital health companies be at the level of, you know, the Ubers and Airbnbs of the world? What kind of hell has to freeze over for us to get there?
I mean, look, again, I don't know how many, you know, how do we compare it to the rides of Uber? But, you know, if you think about Livongo that went public at $3.6 billion, you know, over a course, I want to say they built it over a course of 7 years, went public in at $3.6 billion and then sold it to Teladoc for 18 something. I think we're going to see a bunch of companies SPAC out. Which we're seeing that already, you know, with the SPACs. So from your valuation perspective, you know, I would argue some of hitting some of those valuations here and there, right? From a, I'll say, outcome or output perspective, right? And, you know, social output perspective, I think we got a long way to go still. You know, I probably would not want to compare the number of Uber rides worldwide to a number of, you know, coaching sessions through any of those digital companies today, nowhere right. near.
Yeah, probably magnitude of difference. Okay. Okay, so we've talked about some of the positive trends and you know, things to keep your eyes on. What are the trends that concern you the most in maybe not just digital health, but even healthcare in general?
So, you know, I think you probably won't like my answer, or even some of the viewers. I'm generally, the people that know me, my cup is always half full, right? So I always try to find the positive in any situation. And my comment earlier that I think what we don't want all of this to turn into is the Black Mirror, right? It's the, you know, British show. So I think that's probably one of the things that I wouldn't say concern me, because again, I do think with any technology, there's always going to be more good than evil, right? As we're sort of moving forward as a society. I do have some concerns around just individuals in this world kind of burning out, mental health crisis that is already hitting us hard, I think. And I think people also forget that you don't need fancy technology for that. I think something to even remember is if you don't hear from a friend for that seems like out of norm, just pick up that FaceTime video or whatever works, just reach out.
Yeah. Thank you for that answer, because if you listen back, I was trying to get words out when I was asking the question, what are the biggest trends you're concerned with? And actually, physician burnout was the first thing there. And I was going to maybe lead you there, but I didn't need to lead you. It's such a big problem, clearly, that that's right where you're headed.
Yeah, I mean, physician burnout, absolutely. But I think we're all human beings, including physicians, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, if you think about, I'm sorry to say, but you're even delivery guy for, you know, Uber Eats, right? I mean, they're literally risking their life as well on the front lines with the crisis, right? So I think, and not knowing when the next paycheck is going to come. So I think, you know, and this is around the world. So I think it's not just about physician burnout. I think every individual.
Yeah. All right, Eugene. Well, I've used up all my time. Ironically, this was a conversation that was supposed to be about digital health, but I feel like we ended up talking about people, and the power is really at the core of the person. And you got to, you got to look at things holistically, and that human element is the thing that's.
Yeah, I mean, we said it, I think, through this interview. I think the word digital will just disappear from digital health, right? And it's at the end of the day, it's about health of you as an individual. And, you know, talking about the mental health piece, just again, I wanted to kind of give my two cents at the end of this is you have to take care of yourself first before you can help others. So back to the human nature of it all.
Yeah, back to human nature. All right, Eugene, good words to end it on. Thank you so much for joining me.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Awesome.